हेलो गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन, टुडे वी विल सी द थर्ड पार्ट ऑफ चैप्टर साउंड क्लास 8। द साउंड प्रोड्यूस्ड बाय अ वाइब्रेटिंग बॉडी इज अ फॉर्म ऑफ एनर्जी। वी हैव सीन अबाउट द साउंड, द डेफिनेशन ऑफ साउंड। साउंड इज अ फॉर्म ऑफ एनर्जी and this energy requires medium to travel. Here the question is how sound travels. So sound travels through medium. Sound requires medium to travel. We had seen in the earlier videos that sound is produced by vibrating bodies, and these vibrating bodies transfer the energy to the surrounding molecules, air molecules, which then starts vibrating with the same frequency, and again the molecules pass on these vibrations to the neighboring molecules, and then the next one, and so on, and finally it reaches up to the listener. When the sound is slow, or you can say feeble, when it is not louder, then sound cannot go to a large distance, to a further distance. Why? Because the energy gets finished earlier. When sound is feeble, energy is less. When sound is louder, energy is more. Here we have been given example along with the diagram that the air molecules get compressed, the air molecules get spread, and they spread in all direction when a drummer strikes a drum. The drum skin vibrates up and down. When it goes up, it compresses the air molecules near it. The air molecules comes closer in this part, these parts. And when these air molecules get compressed, the air molecules, these air molecules push against their neighboring air molecules. And again, when this stretched skin membrane moves downward, the air molecule is spread in a larger distance. It spreads out again. And in this way we can say compression and rarefactions are formed in the air. And thus in this way sound is passed from one molecule of the air to the next one, from the next one to the neighboring next one, and so on. And when the sound has traveled to some distance, the vibration dies out. Why? Because the energy has been lost. And if I will speak louder, when your teacher speaks louder in the classroom, till the last bench the sound is heard. And if or he or she will speak slowly, feeble sound, his or her sound will end up in the middle of the class only. The last bench students cannot listen. The louder the sound, or the greater the amplitude of the vibration, the greater is the distance traveled by them before they die out. Now we will see that we have already seen that sound needs medium to travel. Verbally we have seen. Now we will perform an experiment to understand that sound needs medium to travel. What we will do? We will take a jar. We will take a jar which is tightly sealed, and in that jar we'll A hole is made at the bottom. To the hole, a vacuum pump is connected. And in the jar, we will keep a transistor or a mobile. Then what we will do? We will call with another mobile on this number, this mobile. We can hear the sound, ringing sound of the mobile. Here transistor has been given. You can take instead of that mobile also. Now what we will do then? We can hear the sound of the ringing going on in this mobile. Now we will switch on the switch of this vacuum pump. What happens? We will keep on ringing then on this number. And as we will switch on the switch of this vacuum pump, we will see that the sound is getting slowly feeble. The sound, the ringing sound of this mobile is becoming feeble slowly, and then after some time we are unable to listen. Why are we not able to listen? Because this vacuum pump takes out all the air and there is no medium to transfer the sound. So this activity proves that sound needs medium to travel. Sound cannot travel in vacuum. So now we have seen that sound needs medium to travel. Sound can travel in solid, sound can travel in liquid, and sound can travel in gases. Sound travels fastest in solid. When you talk about the speed of sound, you will see that the sound travels fastest in solids. For example, in the case of steel, the speed of sound is 5100 meter per second. In a liquid, for example, you take water, it is more or less around 1500 meter per second. And in air, it is 340 meter per second. So now we can understand by this speed that has been told by our scientists, that after experiments they have found out and they have told us these speeds. So we can understand the sound travels fastest in solids, then liquids, and slowest in gases. When there is a race between the light and the sound, then the light wins the race. You can understand this when you see during rainy season, monsoon season, there is thundering and lightning. First we see the lightning and then we hear the thundering. Both are produced at the same time because of the collision of the clouds among one another or against one another. What happened? Lightning is being produced and thundering sound is also produced. But first we see lightning because the speed of light is 3 lakh meter per second or 3 into 10 to the power 8 meter per second. 3 lakh kilometer per second or 3 into 10 to the power 8 meter per second. And the speed of sound is 340 meter per second. So it is much slow. The speed of sound is much slow than that of the speed of light. Therefore first we see the lightning and then we hear the thundering. Now the question is why the speed of sound is much more in solids than in liquids and gases. Because sound travels with the help of vibrations. And in solid, the particles are very closely packed. The atoms are very closely packed. The molecules are packed closely in solids than in liquids and gases or air. And since molecules carry the vibration, they do very efficiently when they are closer to one another. So in case of solids, because the particles are very closer, molecules are much closer, sound travels fastest in solids. Sound also carries much farther through liquids and solid than through air. But sounds are clearer and louder when heard through liquids and solids rather than air. And this is the reason why whales can communicate with each other over even 100 kilometers far they are. Now we are told to perform an activity. In this activity, what we will do? We will take an alarm clock, put it on a table, and will stand around 1 meter away from the alarm clock and listen to its tick tick. Now we'll put our head down on the bench over which we have placed this alarm clock and try to listen to the sound. What we will see, what we will hear the sound louder when we keep our ear on this bench or whatever bed or whatever you have, on what you have kept that alarm clock. In earlier case, the tick tick was coming from through the air to your ears, but when next time when you have put your ear on the bench, now the sound is traveling through that sound, through that solid, and so you can hear it more louder. Now we have next one here. Any device that can carry sound over a distance is a telephone. The earliest efforts to produce a device in which sound could be carried by electricity were made in 1860s. In the early telephone, a stretched parchment in the mouthpiece vibrated with the sound, and these vibrations were converted into a fluctuating electric current. And that made the parchment in the receiver to vibrate, and these vibrations reached the ear of the listener, and thus in this way the telephone worked. But you must have seen children playing with toy telephone. How is that toy telephone made? You take a paper cup, make a hole, take a matchstick, tie it to a thread and pass it the thread through the hole. Take the other end of the thread to another paper cup. In that cup also you make a hole and pass the thread, and the other end you tie a matchstick or any thin stick so that the thread doesn't come out on being pulled. And then two of your friends can play with this toy telephone. One friend will take this cup to the other side, and the other friend will take this cup to the other side. And what will happen? One of you try to speak, and the other one try to listen. Very slowly you have to speak, very feeble sound you have to speak, so that the sound, the what you are speaking, that doesn't travel through the air and reach to your friend. And then when you speak through this, your friend can easily hear on the other end. How is it? Because when he is speaking, then the sound is traveling through this solid thread, and then it is reaching up to your friend. So when the friend is speaking, the paper cup works better than it can than the through the air. Or if you take a tin cup, better than it will be paper cup, because tin cannot vibrate so much, paper can easily vibrate, and so when it will vibrate more easily, the sound can travel more easily to the other end. Sometime we are told to do activity to understand that sound can travel through solid. So this one we can tell. When we are told about to travel through air, that is very common, all of us are speaking and talking to one another through the air only. And if we are told about liquid, about water, then what you will do, you take a bucket and fill it half with water. Take a squeaking toy, that means such type of toy that produces sound. Place that toy in a polythene bag and seal it nicely so that water doesn't go inside and make your toy go out of order. And then what you do, you put that squeaking toy, sound producing toy into the bucket, and then what you will do, you press that, it will produce sound, and from outside you can still listen the sound made in the inside the water. Thus it is clear that sound can travel through water, that is a liquid. So we come to the conclusion, sound can travel through solid, liquid and gases. Now next we have sound made, our next topic is sound made and heard by animals. All higher animals, mammals and birds, communicate with each other by making sounds with the help of the vocal cords. They communicate with each other, that means they talk with one another by making sound with the help of their vocal cords. And among the lower animals, frogs have got vocal cords. Some insects, they make sound, loud noises. How do they make loud noises? They do not have vocal cord, but they make noises. So how do they do? Either they may be rubbing the wings together. Yes or no? By rubbing the wings together, or by rubbing their hind legs against the wings. See here, some insects like cricket produce sound by rubbing their wings together. You must have heard the singing of the mosquito, flies, butterfly. How do they produce sound? They produce sound by vibrating their wings. While grasshopper make a loud noise by rubbing their hind legs against their wings. Snakes hiss by forcing air out of their mouth and they produce sound. The humming of the bees, mosquitoes and flies is caused by the vibration of their wings that I already told you. One more thing that we should have seen in this part about sound needs medium to travel, that what we have, that the case of the moon and the outer space we must see. That the moon has no air or atmosphere at all. It is a vacuum or empty, we can say. Sound cannot be heard directly on the surface of the moon, because we have studied that sound needs medium to travel. And there is no air on the moon. There is no air in space. Then how do our scientists or astronauts who go there talk to one another? Can they directly talk to one another? No, they cannot talk to one another directly. The astronauts who land on the moon or walk in the outer space, they talk to one another through wireless sets using radio waves, because radio waves can travel even through vacuums. More detail you will study in upper class. Now the next part is how we speak. How do we speak? The organ which helps us to speak is called the larynx. And where it is found? The larynx lies between the pharynx and the trachea. And when we exhale out air through the larynx, the two folds of the tissue within it vibrates, and then the sound is produced. And what are those folds called? Those folds, we call them as the vocal cords. and they also control the size of the opening of the larynx. When vocal cords become tight, taut and thin, and the opening of the larynx become narrow, then the frequency of the sound produced increases. Or you can say the frequency depends on the length of the vocal cord. And you know, women sound are more pitched than men because their vocal cords are short. So when these vocal cords vibrate, then sound is being produced and we are able to speak. Now next is, how do we hear sound? How are we able to hear sound? We are able to hear sound with the help of our ears. Our ears, human ears, have been divided into three parts. You can say the outer part, the outer ear, the middle ear, and the inner ear. The outer ear consists of this part which you call the pinna, and then the ear canal. What is the function of this pinna? This pinna collects the sound from outside and then it forces it towards the inside of the ear through this ear canal. Or you can understand in this way, that when the sound vibration reaches the ear, the air molecules inside the canal starts vibrating, and then this vibration is passed on to the thin membrane here, stretched membrane, elastic membrane, which we call the eardrum. This eardrum is the portion which separates the outer ear from the middle ear. This eardrum is also known as tympanum, and you can say that this canal, ear canal, is around 2 to 3 centimeters long. And when this vibration has reached to the eardrum vibrates, and then in the middle of the ear, the middle part of the ear consists of this eardrum and the three small bones which we call the hammer, the anvil, and the stirrup. The hammer, the anvil, and the stirrup. When the vibration has reached to this eardrum, the eardrum vibrates. From here, the vibration is passed on to these three bones. The signal, or you can say the vibration, passes on to the next part of the ear, that is called the inner ear. The inner ear consists of the cochlea and the, what you call, the auditory nerve. The vibration is passed on from the stirrup to the cochlea, and to the cochlea is attached the auditory nerves. These auditory nerves takes the vibration in terms of signals to the brain. And then what happens? The brain manipulates and we are able to understand what we have heard. This is how we are able to hear the sound. So this part about the middle ear, the in the inner ear, I have already explained. Now we have what we and other animals hear. See, we human beings can hear sound of frequency between 20 hertz to 20,000 hertz. And this is called the audible range. AUDIBLE, audible range. And if the sound is of frequency less than 20 hertz, then we call them as infrasonic sound or infrasonic vibration. And these sound cannot be heard by we human beings. and those sounds which are of frequency more than 20,000 hertz, they are known as ultrasonics or ultrasonic sound, and again we human beings cannot hear these sound, these ultrasonic sound. The range of sound produced and heard by other animals are different from those produced and heard by we human beings. So rhinoceros communicate with one another by using infrasonic sound, and that has got a frequency as low as around 5 hertz. Whales and elephants also, they produce sound of infrasonic range. So we are not able to hear this infrasonic vibration. We human beings cannot hear infrasonic range. Dogs, cats, monkeys and bats are some animals which can hear ultrasonic sound. Dolphins, porpoises and whales can make as well as hear ultrasonic vibrations. They communicate with each other through low audible barks, moans and whistles, but they find their way using ultrasonic vibration. Try to understand, they communicate, they talk with each other through low frequency one, audible barks, but when they try to find their way, then they find using ultrasonic vibrations. Dogs can hear vibrations up to 40,000 hertz, and monkeys, deer, cats, porpoises, leopards can hear sounds, ultrasonic sounds up to 50,000 hertz, but we human beings can hear up to only 20,000 hertz. So we come to the conclusion that the range of the sound produced by animals does not always match the range of the sound they can hear. In fact, some animals like a snake can make sound through their mouth when they force out the air, as we have seen in the last page here. Snakes hiss by forcing air out through their mouths. Here in this part we had seen, but they do not have ear and they cannot hear any sound. Try to understand, snakes do not have ear and they cannot hear sound, although they can produce sound by forcing air out of their mouth, and we call the hissing sound. We say snakes hisses. Next we have reflection of sound. As light can be reflected, in the same way sounds can also be reflected, absorbed and transmitted to different extent by different materials. All those materials that are soft, porous, like cloth, thermocol, cotton, wool, they are good absorbers of sound and poor reflectors of sound. And where we want to decrease the reflection of sound in big halls or auditorium, etc., then we use these cloth, thermocol, cotton and wool, etc., to reduce the reflection of sound. Hard surfaces like concrete walls and metals, they are good reflectors of sound. You must have experienced in your house also that for whitewashing your room, when you take out everything from the room and when you speak in that room, then you are able to hear the reflection of sound, the echo, repeated sound you can hear. But when there are things filled in the room, curtain is there, clothes are there, almira is there, all other things are filled in the room, then what you do, you don't hear any reflection of sound. So what are reflection of sounds known as? Reflection of sound is known as echo. Echoes are reflected sounds. You must have heard echoes in long corridors or large empty halls. Because the speed of sound in air is 340 meter per second, and our ear can hear the echo of a sound only if it takes 1/10 of a second. Here in your book it is given 1/15. It is wrong. It should be 1/10 of a second. And so when you multiply 1/10 into 340, you will get here 34 meter. 34. So what does it mean? That means the distance of going and the distance of coming is 34. So 34 divided by 2, it is 17 meter. That means if a room is or a hall is having length 17 meter or more, then we will hear the reflection of sound in that. But why don't we hear the reflection of sound at all time, even though there are plenty of reflectors of sound all around us? This is because we can distinguish between two sounds only if there is a timing gap of between them 1/10 of the second. Or in simple words, we can say that we can hear reflection of sound, we can hear echo of a sound only if it takes 1/10 of a second to hit the reflecting surface and come back to our ear. So if it is closer than that, so in our small rooms, houses, we don't have that much big halls, corridors, etc. So what happened? They are closer to that. They are closer to us. And it is closer than that distance of 17 meter. And therefore, the echo follows the original sound. Too fast for us to tell that they are separate. And hence, we are not able to listen the echo of the sound. We are not able to listen echo every now and then. But we are able to listen echo, we are able to hear the repeated sound when we go in a big auditorium, and if the sound absorbing material is not there. Or in the at night time when you hear, or in the during the daytime when you hear the bhajans going on, or the in the Muslims what we have, the milad going on, the maulvi is speaking, then what happens? We can hear the echo. Why? Because they have mics, they have loudspeakers fitted up, so those sound through the loudspeaker go to the longer distances. For example, we can have high mountains or high buildings around that, and then they strike with that and they reflect, and we are able to hear the echo of that sound. Now the question is, how can we reduce echoes? We can reduce echoes by using sound absorbing materials. When you go to big auditorium or function halls, what you see that they do not have a concrete over the top one. That means the ceiling is not made of concrete one. It may be made of tin, asbestos or wood, and then from the bottom they have a false ceiling, and that false ceiling is usually made up of the thermocol sound absorbing material. And thus in this way, when the function is going on in that auditorium or the hall, then what happened? Sound reflection is reduced. Even in good halls or auditorium, you will see what is there when on the walls thermocols are fitted, or there are so many curtains are there to reduce the reflection of sound. And you must have seen even that hall and auditorium made in such a way that there is less reflection of sound. See here in your book it has been given, when we need to be more particular about reducing reflection, as in auditorium and theaters, we use special absorbing materials to cover the walls and the ceilings. Next we have application of echoes, this reflection of sound. So reflection of sound is used to locate the underwater objects and measure the depth of the sea. How do they do? They send signal or sound from the top of the ship. On the surface of the water, the ship is there, and then they send with the help of a special device called the sonar, S-O-N-A-R, capital S, capital O, capital N, capital A, capital R, sonar, that is sound, navigation and ranging. Sonar is what? It is a special device which is used to find the depth of a sea or to locate the underground water things like shoals of fish, shipwrecks and enemy submarines. So how does that sonar work? Sonar works by sending short bursts of ultrasonic sound from a ship down into the sea water. And when that sound goes down deep into the sea water, then what happens? They strike with the objects there or to the bottom surface of the sea, and then they return. And in this meantime, what the person who are on the ship, they do, they see the time of going and coming. That means when they had sent the signal and when they reached back. So the gap they see, the timing they see. And then what is there? The speed of sound in water is more or less 1500 meter per second. And then they find mathematically, they calculate what distance is equal to speed into time, and they are able to find the depth, where how much depth is at that point in the sea. Next we have doctors use echoes to get a picture of the internal organs of the body. Ultrasonic vibrations reflected by the different parts of an organ help to create an image of the organ, and this technique is called the echocardiography if it is done in the case of a heart, and if it is done in the case of other organs of the body, then it is known as ultrasonography. You can see here an image produced using ultrasonography showing a baby inside the mother's womb. Now next we have bats. They use echoes to locate their prey, what they eat. They emit out ultrasonic vibrations, and those vibrations they go and strike the prey or the obstacle in their path. It returns to them, and then they judge out how much distance the prey is or the object from what it has struck and returned is. And by the help of the sense organ, they find out whether that thing from which the reflection of the sound has taken place is their prey or is the obstacle in the path. If it is their prey, they will move in the same direction. They will move in the forward direction. And if their sense of smell tells them, by smelling they understand that no, it is not the food, it is not their prey, it is the obstacle, then they change their direction. You must have seen bats moving at a much speed, much faster. Sometimes they may even strike, they hit us, they may hit our head, they get hit with the wall, to the branches of the trees and etc. And sometimes they fall on the ground and we are able to see them. Porpoises, whales, seals use echoes to find their way around in water. And this method we call it as echolocation. Echolocation. So you can understand in this way that bats search their prey like flying insects by the method of echolocation. Or bats fly in the darkness of night without colliding with other objects or obstacles by the method of echolocation. So this chapter is over. You all study nicely. Watch the video again. Again you try to listen it and try to understand the chapter. Wish you all the best. Thank you.